Hi, my name is Andrew Aronson, and I'm from the University of Chicago, and I'm also one of the co-chairs for the AASLD and IDSA HCV guidelines. It's a pleasure to present information about HCV point-of-care testing and the test-and-treat approach. First, a little bit about the HCV guidance. This was launched in 2014, and it was a joint effort between the IDSA and the AASLD, and is really geared towards giving providers up-to-date recommendations on the care of hepatitis C patients. This is a living document that is consistently updated with new guidance, new research and evidence, and also new recommendations based on that evidence. There's also a publication every other year, which alternates between hepatology and clinical infectious disease. But what I'd like to present is some of the new features of the guidelines that are coming out, namely about point-of-care testing and test-and-treat algorithms. A lot of the data that is founding these new recommendations comes from the MINMON study, which was published in Lancet Gastro and Hepatology in 2022. And this was really a groundbreaking multi-center study that really simplified hepatitis C care to a point where we hope that it can be accessible for almost anybody. Some important points about this study was there was no pretreatment genotyping. Cirrhosis was determined based on Fib4 only. All treatment, importantly, was provided at the time of entry into the study. And also, there was very little monitoring during the treatment. There was a phone call at week 4 and week 22, as well as the obvious SVR check at week 24. And what we saw from this study, that patients did extremely well. Out of the 399 patients enrolled, 379 were cured of their hepatitis C using this very simplified model, many of whom were mono-infected with hepatitis C, but many were also co-infected with HIV as well and were having high results of SVR in all groups that were studied. So based on this data, the HCV Guidelines Committee came up with what we call a one-pager, which was a simplified regimen to treat hepatitis C. And this was a PDF, and it still is a PDF that you can find on our website, that really takes you through from the beginning to the end of how to treat hepatitis C for most patients. There's one for those who are treatment naive without cirrhosis and one who are treatment naive with compensated cirrhosis. And what this does from beginning to end will take you through the pre-treatment assessment, so what labs are needed, how to do a medication reconciliation to look for drug-drug interactions, some key points about educating patients, and then the medications to start the patient on, whether it's glucapivir and pibrentosphere or sofosbuvir and velpatasvir. It also goes through on-treatment monitoring, as well as what to do after the course of treatment and how to check for an SVR. This is great, and this is far simplified from previous regimens that we've had. However, there are some limitations that I think are really important. First of all, this requires at least 2 trips to see a provider. And for many patients, this can sometimes be a bridge too far that can impede on treatment outcomes. The second is this is very difficult to achieve in non-traditional settings. There's a requirement for lab values to come back and venipuncture. And of course, this doesn't incorporate what I'm here to talk about, which is some point of care hepatitis C testing. So just to differentiate, point of care hepatitis C tests have been around for a while, but they haven't all been the same. So there has been an antibody test that has been available that is a blood-based test. But of course, this gives you a hepatitis C antibody. So it's impossible to tell whether somebody has been exposed and cured, exposed and cleared the virus, or actually has an active infection. Whereby nucleic acid testing, which is now available, is a finger stick test that will actually give you a qualitative RNA result within an hour. So in the summer of 2024, the Xpert HCV test became available, and this is a point of care test, which is a finger stick assay. So just a finger stick blood sample is needed, not a traditional venipuncture. This blood is put into the cartridge and a result for a qualitative HCV RNA comes back in about an hour or less. So this is far better in determining an active infection and a chronic infection than previous antibody tests and is really the cornerstone for test and treat algorithms. But looking at which test to use, I think it's really important to note that not all patients should get a point of care test, and there's different situations which may be better for different patients. So this isn't a plea to do this for every single patient coming in. In many cases, you can see here at the top of this chart, a two-step traditional HCV antibody test can be very helpful. Of course, this is sending an HCV antibody test that will reflex to an RNA if the antibody is positive. Advantages here are that this is widely available in most clinical settings. It's easily integrated with other laboratory-based testing as part of general laboratory work, and in many cases might be a least expensive option. A single step on the bottom HCV RNA test may have a lot of advantages as well. This is going to detect early HCV infections because it's an RNA test. It's very easy to do because it just needs a finger stick and not a traditional venipuncture. If you're in a place that does not have easy access to phlebotomy or laboratory testing, this could be very helpful. And I think a very important point is then we're able to give our patients a test result on the same day as the encounter because results come back in 60 minutes or less. So different settings are likely going to be important for different testing. If you're in a place that has high HCV prevalence, probably a single step makes the most sense. Certainly, if you have a brief encounter with a patient and it might be difficult to bring that patient back for a variety of reasons, point of care testing makes a lot of sense because you're going to get an answer for that patient right there. If you don't have phlebotomy, again, point of care testing would make sense. And it also will depend on the client volume. What is your pretest probability and how many patients are you seeing that have hepatitis C may also influence the type of test that you send. So what is the data for using point of care testing in immediate treatment? This is a great study that came out in Lancet in 2023 that looks at 128 participants in a supervised consumption service at a community health center in Toronto. All the patients got point of care testing and were referred for on-site treatment right then and there. And of these 124 participants that ultimately were in the study, 64 had a positive HCV RNA, and 25 of those were cured. And when you look at populations like this, this cure rate is higher than almost any other study, and really shows that these types of programs can be very, very helpful in curing hepatitis C, especially in high-risk patients. So this leads us to our most recent guidance. So this is from our website that you can find on the landing page. There is a PDF that is on the landing page that goes through our test and treat algorithm. I'd like to spend a minute or two just going through this algorithm that you can see on the right. Starting at the top, the recommendation is to do point of care testing with HCV RNA, a pregnancy test, and an HIV test. If that HCV RNA is positive, history should be taken to verify if the patient has had prior DAA treatment, has a known hepatitis B infection, known hepatocellular carcinoma, or any evidence of decompensated disease. If any of these are positive or present, then this patient will, in most cases, benefit from a specialist consultation and somebody that has a lot of experience with HCV. As we know, in most cases, that is not going to be the case, and many of these patients are going to be naive to treatment and not have evidence of decompensated disease, at which time a standard medication reconciliation is recommended. And then labs are recommended to be drawn, which is an AST, an ALT, platelet, and hepatitis B surface antigen. Now, these labs need to be drawn at this visit, but they don't need to be resultant, okay? Because we're really screening for presence of cirrhosis and a hepatitis B infection. That can be dealt with when the labs come back, but the treatment can still be given at that time. A conversation should happen about hepatitis B and the risks of hepatitis B flaring with the patient if they do have hepatitis B, and let the patient know that when those results come back, they're going to get a phone call on whether they need further management for their hepatitis B, hep C co-infection. But all patients should be treated at that time with glucapivir and fabrenchosphere for 8 weeks or sofosbuvir and velpatasvir for 12 weeks. If that patient does happen to have hepatitis B surface antigen, then you'll reach out to the patient and they'll be either monitored or treated based on our AASLD IDSA guidance. And if they're negative, then they will continue on with their hepatitis C therapy. So I hope I've shown over the last few minutes that point of care testing will play a vital role in hepatitis C diagnosis, treatment, and ultimately our hopes in hepatitis C elimination. There are lots of different ways to test for hepatitis C now. Point of care is one of them, but that doesn't mean that's the case for everybody. So different settings and different clinical scenarios may be appropriate for different ways of setting. It's nice to have some options now. Test and treat programs are going to be essential for hepatitis C elimination, but this is going to be tough. Solutions are going to require lots of coordinated efforts, certainly political will, multidisciplinary approach amongst providers. And we know that each of these settings is going to be unique for each patient population and each treatment paradigm. Thank you so much for the time.